This is Ham Radio Now, episode 287 from the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference, 2016 version, last September in St. Petersburg, Florida. Bring that thing in there. The tick.
I am the tick.
No, not that one. But if you haven't seen it, I sort of recommend that show. The 2001 version. There's also a cartoon. There's a movie. I think there's a comic book, but the 2001 TV show is the one that I've seen. It is quirky, it is stupid, and so maybe you like it too. I think I saw it on Netflix. I don't think it's streaming anymore, anyplace, so too bad. Okay, so this is the TAPR TICC, T-I-C-C. It's a little kit for measuring time to the trillionth of a second using an Arduino. It's going to be presented by John Ackermann in a UR. John is a Time Lord. Nope. Another TV show reference, and I have already pushed fair use about as far as I'm willing to for this episode. So no clever video on Time Lords. John is a time nut. And he will explain why anybody would want to measure time to a trillionth of a second. So stay tuned if you've got the time. Get it? Ham Radio Now and the DCC are brought to you by you. It starts with the 70 of you who supported the Kickstarter, three of whom in particular came up to the corporate underwriter level, and that begins with the TAPR itself. And since this talk is really one long commercial for a TAPR kit, I'm not going to say a lot more about them, except that if you're interested in anything digital in amateur radio, TAPR probably is too. And so stop by tapr.org and become a member. And if for some reason they're not already doing what you're interested in, well, maybe you should join and present that missing link at the next DCC. Next is Chud. Thank you to corporate underwriter Chud from Node Systems Limited. Chud's call signs are M1PUP and 2E1BXW. Chud is in London, UK-based Worldwide Projects, providing technical project management, design and build in telecommunication systems, security systems, SCADA, command and control systems, mainly in the police, ambulance, and rail sector. Contact Chud by email at chud, C-H-U-D, at nodesystems.co.uk, or you can follow him right here on Twitter. This is his Twitter page, at Node Systems, and I think that's probably Chud holding his breath there until you send him email. And finally, we are brought to you by that anonymous ham who wants you to think about ways to introduce ham radio to young people who might be interested if only they knew we existed beyond that dusty old junk that's sitting up in their grandparents' attic or down in their basement or out in the garage or something. And I'm afraid that might be you that I'm talking about. Okay, so I heard some interesting stuff on this podcast, the new Phasing Line podcast that's put out by Marty, KC1CWF, and Sterling N0SSC. They spend a lot of time talking about contesting antennas, and I'm thinking that what they're talking about is old ham stuff. And the conventional wisdom is that young people are all about the digital stuff, are digital modes, although nobody who ever says that gets really specific about what it is. They just say, yeah, the kids, they like our digital stuff. Well, so I'm thinking that these guys are really old hams in young ham bodies. And I'm thinking that we old hams, we celebrate when a young ham wants to do contesting or work DX or learn Morse code, all the old ham stuff, except maybe for 75 meter rag chewing about their health problems. Pretty common. Well, I'm thinking that maybe we shouldn't be promoting all that stuff just because a few kids seem to like it, Sterling and Marty, because most kids want to do the digital stuff. And then Sterling on this podcast says, well, that isn't true. Young hams like the traditional stuff, and they don't really care that you could have slow text conversations on PSK31 or even slower conversations on Whisper. And so that upsets my apple cart, and it gives me something to think about. I was really getting comfortable with the kids like digital meme. Maybe it gives you something to think about, too. Meanwhile, Sterling likes to talk about the Collegiate Amateur Radio Initiative. This is their Facebook page. And down here it will say that the group is to help promote amateur radio among college clubs and provide a place to share ideas, projects, and advice related to amateur radio in a college club setting. I think there's no question that we need an amateur radio presence in schools, in college, in high schools, maybe even elementary and middle schools, and in every one of them, not just one or two in a community. I've seen school clubs wax and wane, and I know that their success depends on adult involvement, faculty, alumni, even hams in the local community. That provides the continuity that it takes to keep a club going as students graduate and move on with their lives. It also helps with equipment, antennas, funding. Most successful clubs have a station that students can operate because they probably don't have the money or location to put one up of their own, which reminds me of a school station that I saw a few years ago at Stanford University. I've got some video of it here in Ham Radio Now episode 32, which you will find on YouTube. And okay, most school stations aren't going to be this big or have this many antennas, but this one is aspirational. But you get the idea. This is where we can reach a lot of young people and show them what we've got. But you need something to show, and a school station is the core, along with the continuity of adult hams who keep things going. Maybe kind of in the background because the students also need ownership of their club. They got to run things with your help. And so maybe they will run a contest, or maybe they'll design and build a software-defined radio from scratch. Or maybe just a time counter to see how many trillionths of a second there are left in whatever boring class they're sitting in now. Or boring ham radio show they're watching. Which reminds me of what we're supposed to be doing in this episode. So a quick reminder that if you didn't get in on the Kickstarter and you want to help out, we still need your financial help. Stop by hamradionow.tv. Visit my buddy Arvin sitting back there. Barely see you, Arvin. He'll take you to the contribution page at hamradionow.tv, and you can make a one-time contribution using PayPal or a credit card, or join the Patreon to start a monthly contribution as little as a buck a month, and it's easy to turn that off anytime you want to. So thanks to everybody who supported the Kickstarter, everyone else who makes a direct contribution. I couldn't afford to do this without your help. And now on to the DCC. Here's Steve and John.
All right, so we've made the transition. We're ready to get started with Saturday morning's talks. I'd like to introduce John Ackermann, N8UR, and his talk on the TAPR TICC, the counter measuring trillionths of a second with an Arduino. Who'd have thought? Go away, John.
Good morning. I've been accused of having a product lifecycle design that consists of, first of all, thinking up an acronym, and then reverse engineering what that stands for, and then figuring out a project that will do what that stands for. And that's kind of what this is. So I'll give you the sneak preview first, and then tell you why. I'm not going to go into the deep technical things about how it works, because that requires a large amount of hand-waving, and you'd still fall asleep. But I'm happy to talk to anyone after the presentation about it, and I do have a live demo running over in the demo room. So the TICC, this is a version of it. It stands for, we're not sure quite what it stands for yet, but something like totally integrated cycle counter. It's an electronic stopwatch. And it's the best stopwatch you've ever seen because it can time events up to 192 days apart with 60 picosecond precision. So that's like a few million seconds to the left of the decimal point and then 12 digits to the right of the decimal point. And there are actually reasons why you might want to do that, although I don't blame you if you can't figure out what they are. Done as a shield on a Arduino Mega 2560. So we have some special hardware that uses a couple of chips that Texas Instruments makes that make the whole thing possible. And then all the processing is done in the Arduino, and it just spits out the time results via USB to a host computer that does the further processing. I will pass this around. This is Rev-A. It's not worth stealing because, first of all, it doesn't work, and secondly, it might catch fire.
So
I'm one of the time nuts, and my main interest in doing this is related to time and frequency measurement, but there really are some other applications that might be interesting. Because we can do really short stopwatch kinds of things, think about a radar. Think about ultrasonics or echo ranging kind of things acoustically, which is actually what the TI chip was originally designed for. You know, think about stock car races. If you want to measure when the bumper crosses the line with a photo cell, you know, 60 trillionths of a second, we can tell who won. So lots and lots of possible uses for this thing, and I'm encouraging you to think them up. It's open source software, and this is actually the first project that TAPR's done where the development has been entirely based on GitHub. So you can see all the ugliness of the code right now as we continue to make it work better. It is just about ready to go for an initial version 1 release. And the hardware is currently, the working board that I have in the demo room is Rev-C. It actually works perfectly. We're going to add a couple of extra jumpers and some things to make it a little bit more flexible. And the hope is that we'll have the units available to sell sometime around the first of the year. Whether it'll be Christmas, I can't say, but certainly I think in January. And the board is probably going to be, I can say, well under $200. It may be under $150. It depends on what kind of quotes we get from the contract manufacturer before we can set the final price. But it will be assembled and tested because there are some fairly tiny chips that you really don't want to try to solder with a blowtorch. So we'll give you a system that will work. So what's the need? And again, I'm getting back to my time nuts world. Well, one of the things that we like to do is measure the frequency and the stability of clocks over a very long time period. And one common example is if you've got a rubidium oscillator, which does drift a little bit over time as it ages, and also may not be precisely on frequency, we can compare that with a signal coming out of a GPS. You can buy a GPS for $20 today that has a pulse per second signal coming out of it that's accurate within much less than 100 nanoseconds. So we have a very precise time signal. The problem is that GPS signal has a lot of noise when you look at it in the short term. But if you average it out over 10 or 100,000 seconds, it becomes accurate down to parts in 10 to the minus 14th, which is like femtoseconds of accuracy. And I've got a couple of plots here that are with my old measurement system showing my laboratory rubidium against the GPS. And this is actually a fairly short measurement run. It's 15 days. I have had runs that have been more than a year to do long-term tracking. And the plot on the left is the phase. So that's just how the signal is from measurement to measurement bouncing around. And the right is a plot, it's called Aaaaand deviation, which is sort of like standard deviation. And it's what most time measurement statistics are based on. And really what it looks like is along the x-axis is the measurement interval. So we're looking, in this case, it's taking a measurement every 3,600 seconds. That's once an hour. And the very left of the plot is, if you were to look at two measurements 1 hour apart, as you go to the right, it's looking at two measurements at the very right, I can't really read it, but nearly 100,000 seconds apart. And this will tell you statistically how much noise there's likely to be when you make those measurements over time. You'll also notice the straight line coming down on the left side of that right-hand plot. That's because it's limited by the resolution of the frequency counter, or the time counter that I was using. And that's what led to this project. The counter here had a 2 nanosecond resolution, but even taking measurements once an hour, I had to get out to nearly 100,000 seconds before I was able to look at the noise of the sources rather than the limitations of the counter. And that's why we wanted to come up with something a little bit easier to work with. The way we do this measurement And I've already talked a little bit about it, but the easiest way to do is really just compare two pulse per second measurements and look at how they change over time. If over time one of them gets faster versus the other, if the offset in time is longer rather than less, well then, you know, one clock is running faster than the other. And that tells you the frequency error. Then you can look at how much the signal bounces around from measurement to measurement. And it will bounce because there's no such thing as a perfect clock. Our motto is, a man with one watch knows what time it is. A man with two watches is never sure. So we can look at the way it bounces around and learn things about how, the stability and, you know, temperature sensitivity and other aspects. So this is a very common method for calculation and measurements for the TimeNut community. And it's used by U.S. Naval Observatory and NIST, as well as people with too much stuff in their basements. So the problem, as I already mentioned, is we're looking at long-term measurements, you know, seconds a day, or maybe nanoseconds a year, if I want to look at my cesium standard compared to a GPS. In a traditional counter or timer, the resolution that you can get from the measurement is limited by the speed of the clock that's running it. If you want to measure 100 microsecond impulses, you have to have a counter that's faster than that. And that starts to be a problem to get more and more resolution. You need a 1 megahertz clock to measure with 1 microsecond of resolution. At 10 megahertz, you can get 100 nanoseconds. And then you keep multiplying. If you want 10 nanoseconds, you have to be 100 megahertz. A 1 nanosecond, you have to be a gigahertz. 100 picoseconds, you have to be 10 gigahertz. That's pretty hard to do. There are fancy, expensive counters that get around that problem by having ways that they interpolate between the ticks of the internal clock, usually an analog, like looking at a capacitor discharging over time. That's complicated. That's expensive. That needs calibration. It works. You can buy surplus stuff that does it, but it's a pain, and we wanted to see if we could do better. And these are some of the solutions that are available today. On the left is an HP 5370 counter. This is the lowest resolution or highest resolution counter you can buy off the shelf. It's out of production now, but you can find them on eBay for $250 to $500. And it can measure 20 picosecond resolution, but its noise, its, the standard deviation in jitter, is around 60 or 70 picoseconds. So it's also 32 pounds. It has it draws 250 VA, worst case, and it has a fan that doesn't quite sound like O'Hare, but it starts to get there. In the middle is a much more modern Hewlett-Packard counter, 53132, and I actually have one of those over at my demo as a comparison with the tick board. It's 150 picoseconds. It only weighs 7.5 pounds and takes 30 watts, so that's not bad. But they're 500 to a grand on eBay. Then the one on the right is actually one of my favorite counters of all time, and it's the one that did the measurements that I showed in those graphs a minute ago. It's a counter from the probably mid-80s to early 90s from Hewlett-Packard, 5334. It's only 12 pounds, 50 VA, and it doesn't have a fan, which is, you don't know how wonderful that is until you're in a small basement room with about 30 devices running, each of them having a fan. And it's cheap. They're $100 to $200, and you can get them with a high-stability oscillator and a frequency channel that'll go to 1.3 gigs. So if you ever find one of these, it's a great find, a great bargain for the performance you get. But it's obsolete, and it's limited to a 2 nanosecond resolution, which is why I could only look at things that were more than 10,000 seconds in order to be able to get the noise from the counter to not be a factor. So we thought to ourselves, what else could we do? And if the slide changes, we'll find out. So the tick. And this really came out of a comment that Tom Van Bock, who's the moderator of the TimeNuts mailing list, that I've had the good fortune to work with for many years. I'm actually the administrator of TimeNuts. It runs on my Phoebo.com server. But Tom is our moderator and our spiritual leader. He's the guy who took a cesium clock up the mountain in Arizona for part of the PBS show that was just on last spring with Stephen Hawking to prove relativity by showing the time difference between a couple of cesium clocks at base and a couple that spent a day up at the top of Mount Lemmon. And Tom put out a note on the mailing list that, you know, I wonder who'll be the first person to come up with a time nuts counter that has better than 1 nanosecond resolution. A couple of people had been working on counters, but they were, you know, maybe 10 nanosecond or so, and they all had this analog interpolator that was a real pain. So I said, I need to think about that. And remember that TI had come out with a couple of really interesting chips that looked like they might be a good building block, and we built the TIC around that. And what we ended up with was 60 picosecond resolution, and the noise is about the same. So this thing really works for the kind of measurements that we're doing, as well as that HP 5370 that weighs 32 pounds, and the last time it was available new in an HP catalog was $25,500. So, yeah, there's some improvements here in mass. Notice 2.6 ounces, that includes the Arduino, 0.4 watts, including the Arduino. And it's going to be pretty cheap. It's implemented as something that's a little bit of a new concept. It's a time stamping counter, and it has two independent channels. What that means is that every time a rising edge of a pulse hits the input, it gets a timestamp. Think about when you're clocking in at work. It's every cycle clocks in, it gets a timestamp, which can be from the time that the system starts until the clock rolls over, 192 days, and it's got 12 digits of fractional precision. So it's able to show that a 60 picosecond resolution. Once you have a timestamp on every edge, you can do all sorts of math and do all the statistics that you want, and there's software available that we can just feed the output of this thing into, and it will automatically create the pretty plots and graphs and tell you the things you'd like to know. So the TIC was something the concept and the challenge from Tom was last February, and I'm kind of amazed that it's now September, so like 8 months later, and we were really basically ready for production, which, given my usual pace for projects, is pretty astounding. So, and the parts aren't even obsolete yet. So, and Rev A and Rev B, which are I'm passing around a Rev A board. The problem was we have to do translation because the parts on the shield are 3.3 volt and the Arduino is 5 volt. So you need the voltage translator chips to go between them. Texas Instruments had a wonderful chip that would automatically tell which way you were trying to send the signal and adjust the voltage correctly. And it's really wonderful, except for the fact that it doesn't work. And we built two revisions of the board and never were even able to test whether the basic concept worked because we couldn't talk to it. And we talked to some other people who tried using that same chip and they said, yeah, same. We have the same issue, it just doesn't work. So there must be some use case out there that TI came up with where it does work, but it's not ours. So for the Rev-C board, we changed to more traditional chips, and I'm just amazed because everything else fired up. As soon as we got the voltage translation finished, we didn't have to change anything in the hardware. So I'm really pleased at how well that worked. And again, I mentioned already, it's a timestamping counter. So we can measure the time of arrival of every clock edge that hits, and there are two independent channels. So I could actually measure two devices separately and get data about either of them. But, and to mimic the way these older counters like the HP work, it's also a time interval counter. So there are two inputs, and we can measure from when a pulse hits channel A, which might be from the clock that you want to test, to when a pulse hits channel B, which might be the GPS. So we can measure the difference between those two clocks and again, do the math just by subtracting and plot how that difference changes over time and get all the statistics that we want. And while we're at it, it can measure the period of the signal. It can measure the total number of events, what's called a totalizer. I'm sure we can measure the ratio of the frequency between the two inputs. So it's all software, and it's actually very simple software. It's all the software is written in the Arduino IDE, so it's a, sort of a bastardized mix of C and C++ and whatever the Italians thought up. But it's a pretty easy environment to work in, and then, again, it's all open source. The one thing that I do need to stress, though, is this is not an RF frequency counter. It won't measure, you know, your HT. It's for low rate signals. Currently, we can do probably 200 or 300 measurements a second. With some more optimization, we might be able to get to 1,000 measurements a second. But it's not designed for measuring what we would think of as RF. It's more these fairly slow rate signals. So what can you do with it? And here is actually the only thing in my presentation that ties in any way to ham radio. So I'm justified in giving the presentation as a result of this slide. So I decided to measure the frequency performance of the Excalibur board that's available for the HPSDR Atlas-based system. It's a TCXO that you can plug in to your HPSDR system and get better frequency stability. So I did a test setup, which is, and I'm dangerous with laser pointers. But there we go. So this is the Excalibur board, which is running at 10 megahertz. And I'm going to step over here so the mic picks it up. So Excalibur running at 10 megahertz, and that's my attempt to show that it's a sine wave. And then we have to reduce that to a pulse per second signal somehow. Well, it just so happens that one of my other backwards acronym named projects is the T2 Mini, and T is short for TAD, and TAD means Totally Awesome Digital Divider. And it's a little PIC chip thing. We sell them for $40. You have to solder on the connectors and the chip socket, but other than that, all the surface mount stuff is put down. You feed 10 megs into that, and you get a pulse per second out. So I hooked up a T2 Mini, got my pulse per second. That went into the tick. I had a GPSDO as providing the 10 megahertz reference that goes into the tick. That went into the PC. And this is what the data looks like coming out of the tick. It's just serial, and it's basically a number with a bunch of decimal points. And if you're looking at a pulse per second signal, the number to the left of the decimal point will increment by one every second. And it has identifier whether it's channel A or channel B. This is the data that we could plot, and I'll show you a larger picture that's easier to read in a moment. So this is the frequency offset measured over a period of, I think we did 4 hours, so 14,400 samples. Over 10,000 seconds averaging, it's, instead of being 10 megahertz, it's actually 9.9999999620, or an error of 1 in 10 to the 7th, which would be less than a cycle at 10 megahertz. So we can do that kind of measurement and look at the short term, long term, and you can see that over this time, it moved. The temperature wasn't completely stable in the room, and it was just doing what crystals do, so there's some jumping in that. And there's another measurement that we can do that's this sort of standard deviation. We call it an Allen deviation that shows here how the stability is very good in the short term, but the longer you go, the more it's likely to jump around. If you measure it every few thousand seconds, you're going to see more error, but still, it's only going to be a few hundredths of a hertz jump. So we can show the stability of that Excalibur oscillator by measuring it for a few hours and learn an awful lot about how it works. And how it works is it's not pretty bad, not too bad, considering that it's an inexpensive TCXO. Another interesting experiment was there are people who spend their time monitoring the frequency of the power coming into their house. And it's a long-term hobby. But it's fairly easy to do, and there's a number of tools to do it. I decided I'd use the tick to try this, and the main reason was I wanted to see if we could do more measurements per second. So for about close to 12 hours, I used a wall-wart AC transformer with a couple of isolation resistors and a voltage divider, and shoved that into the tick, and we time-stamped every zero crossing of 60 hertz. And this is what it looks like. And it shows that the frequent, and this is looking at the phase difference, but think of phase as just the time error at any given point. So we're about, I think if I'm reading that right, about 6 in 10 to the minus 1, so that's 600 milliseconds high. We're also, the worst case is about 600 milliseconds low. We got back up to 600 high, and I don't have the plot here showing the average, but we can see that there's about 600 milliseconds wander overnight in the frequency of the mains. Now it's funny, when I sent this out to Tom Van Bock to ask him if this looked like real, he asked me, "Are you sure that you're not on a UPS? Because this is way, way better than the stability that we get on the Seattle power grid." So, and I'm guessing that the hydropower maybe has more range in frequency to load versus the coal and nuclear that we mainly have on the eastern grid. I know nothing about power systems, so that could be complete BS, but it seems like we're better than they are. So that's at least one advantage of living in Atlanta. And this is the frequency over time. So we can see if we average it for 3,000 seconds, the frequency is 59.98963549 cycles. I'm sorry, hertz. And it's about that translates to about minus 1.7 in 10 to the fourth. So that's what power lines look like if you're interested in that sort of thing. The last experiment that did was to look at one of my cesium clocks versus GPS for several days. And I don't see well enough to tell exactly how long this was, but 2 days, 19 hours, and 37 minutes, going out to about 240,000 seconds. So the blue line, you'll see the solid line that's darker, that's sort of the average by pixel, because we can't stick 240,000 pixels in this image. The larger, slightly lighter gray line, blue area, is the range that the software uses somehow to show how much noise there was versus the actual average when you reduce the pixels. The blue is the GPS signal. The pink is the cesium. And so if you look at this in looking at the phase difference, what you can see is that the GPS is much, much noisier. As we look at this plot, the pink, there's almost no width to that noise band, but the GPS is moving around about 20 nanoseconds plus or minus zero. And that's about what GPS does. It's got 20 nanoseconds thereabouts of noise on the signal from second to second, which is why GPS is a lousy frequency reference if you want to look at it in the short term. But if we average it over a long time, it gets a whole lot better. This is looking at it at a frequency. And if you've ever heard about things called hanging bridges with a GPS signal, that's what you're seeing in this pattern of the slants, the thing in the broader noise of the frequency. Again, the pink is the range of the cesium, the blue is the range of the GPS. And then we can finally do those statistics that I was talking about with the Allen deviation. The blue line is GPS, and as we look at the vertical axis, all you need to know is that lower is better. It's more stable when it's low, and it's more noisy when it's high. So if we're looking at a signal, at a sample every second, the GPS is way up there. The cesium is much better. But as we look out, we're starting to look 50,000 seconds. And by the way, these are both log-log scales. As we get closer, the GPS keeps getting better as a straight line because that's 20 nanoseconds of noise. It's the same 20 nanoseconds whether you're looking every second or whether you're looking every 100,000 seconds. 20 nanoseconds of noise is much less as a fraction of 100,000 than it is as a fraction of one. So the GPS keeps getting better and better over time. The cesium starts to reach its limits. And this, by the way, is a 25 or 30-year-old cesium standard, two generations back from the current stuff. But you see we're almost at the crossover point, and if I'd run this experiment for another several days, we would have seen the blue line crosses over and becomes better than the cesium after a certain amount of measure of averaging. So that's the kind of cool thing that you see about the different sources, and that's also why it's making long measurements is interesting. This is a couple of days, but if I were able to run this experiment for, say, a couple of months, I'd be able to see the noise floor of the cesium where it simply doesn't get any better anymore because of the physics in the clock. So many people think that this is insane, but this is my hobby, and that's why I do it. So I just want to say thanks to a bunch of people who helped out. Tom McDermott in particular, Tom's done a number of projects in conjunction with TAPR, including the TAPR vector network analyzer that ultimately was turned into a product by Tentec. And Tom is who I want to be when I grow up. He's just a great guy, and he actually got involved in this project by mistake. I was sending a message to Tom Holmes, who might be in the room, and who is much less useful in this area. But I accidentally misaddressed it to McDermott. You know, Tom McDermott came up first in my address book. So I sent this note off, and Tom wrote back and said, "What is this tick thing you're talking about? Sounds interesting." And from that point on, he was on the project team. And he did more to make the hardware work and the software work than really anybody else. And without him, this would not be working right now. So I have a lot of thanks to him, but a bunch of other people also helped. George has helped with software, Jeremy with software, Bruce Raymond, who's also here today, helped me with the initial brainstorming about how some of the logic would work. Tom actually did help. But I had to list him pretty far down on the scale. And then Tom Van Bock, who I've already mentioned, gave a lot of insight into how to make sure this thing really worked the right way. And John Miles, KE5FX, has done a lot in the time nuts as well as other measurement areas. And he wrote the software that we all use for capturing data that was all the plots that I showed you. It's called TimeLab. And it's free software, and in the space of about 4 days after I asked, John added some features to his software that would let it work better with the tick. So I was able to get that support added really quickly, and so thanks to John. And one person I forgot to put on is another time nut, although not a ham, named Attila Canali, who works over in Europe and also gave me some great advice as we were working on the logic design. So with that, I'll take any questions. I have the demo running over in the booth. We will be letting you know when this is available, but we do plan to offer a fully assembled version, probably with the Arduino and the then current code burned onto it, so it'll be a plug-and-play device when you get it. And I'm sort of thinking January-ish, give or take a month. No. Any questions?
Eric Tata, KM4NOZ.
Hi, Eric.
People are talking more and more about clocks. They talk about fountains. They talked about optical reference. Now they're talking about flying them in zero G. The mm-hmm. Europeans have been working on it. They're a couple of years behind. Chinese say they'll be up in a year with a much smaller vehicle. I read about it this morning.
Mm-hmm.
Can you give us a brief overview?
Well, first of all, I can't afford any of those things. But there's been a lot of development in the what we call primary clocks, which as of right now, I have a primary reference in my basement in this 30-year-old cesium clock that I have that still works. It's just for your definition of how primary is. The new commercially available cesium clocks are an order of magnitude better than mine, but they work on the same physics principle. So mine is still, mine pumps out the second for some definition of the second that's a little bit noisier than the other ones. But in the national laboratory space, the older cesium clocks that we've all used that have a tube that sends a bunch of cesium ions through a magnetic and RF field and then looks for state changes, that technology is now obsolete. And instead, they're working on things like cesium fountains, where you're trying to keep the cesium atom floating in a measurement area as long as you can. And you do that by slowing it down to very nearly absolute zero by pointing lasers at it. Now, the reason I'm not a physicist is that I can't quite figure out how pointing a laser at something makes it colder. But they do. And they trap this little cloud of atoms in a vacuum and hold it almost still for maybe 100 seconds. And that whole time that it's there, they can probe it and get a much more accurate view of the frequency or the transition that happens. So those accuracies are getting down another one or two orders of magnitude better. And now the new frontier is optical clocks, which have already shown that in the short term, they can be even another order of magnitude more stable. But their accuracy isn't yet determined. So they're not a primary reference because they could be operating at a frequency that doesn't match the official definition of the hertz or the second, whereas a cesium clock does match that definition. But there's talk now about redefining the second in terms of optical clocks, and probably that will happen within the next 10 or 15 years because those clocks are both more stable and they're also learning how to make them more reliable so that they can run long enough to be useful. One of the things with even the cesium fountains is they turn them on and run them for a measurement campaign that might be a few weeks long. They don't run continuously the way the older cesiums or the hydrogen masers, which are also very stable timekeepers, do. Those things run for years, but the more modern technology, it's short-term measurements, and you have to have a certain time period that you can keep the thing running in order to really use it as a standard. So that's work that's going on, and they're putting these things in space, and it's getting really interesting.
Hi, Dick, K2LCT.
Hi, Dick.
Have you looked into the European Galileo? They were supposed to fly hydrogen masers, and I guess they got a few birds up there.
Yeah, I know that Galileo was supposed to be using masers. I think they have some in flight. I don't have any Galileo based equipment yet because it's still quite expensive for the timing grade stuff. But actually, the rubidiums that are on the GPS ain't that bad because they are really, really good quality, but they're steered from the ground. And when you look at the atmospheric disturbances and the other things that degrade the quality of GPS, the typical ground user doesn't see a huge amount of difference based on the quality of the clock in space because they're controlled pretty well from the ground.
Yeah, Mike Johnson, WCS, WE8AE. How much of the drift in the GPS cycles is due to the propagation between Earth and space?
For the single channel GPS, it's almost all a combination of the atmospherics and the coarseness of the measurement that's sent down. So we use, and the GPSs that we all buy, use a single frequency, and it's the civilian grade unencrypted time code. Surveyor receivers and timing receivers use two frequencies, which lets them cancel out most of the ionospheric effects or the atmospheric effects. And they also have a more precise, it's spread spectrum, so there's no edge, but effectively it lets you get a much more precise edge to the time signal by using this proprietary encrypted code that's not available to the general civilian population. And so between those, that's why your GPS may be good for a couple of meters accuracy, but a surveying system, along with post-processing, can do centimeter-grade accuracy between a combination of those factors. Anything else? All righty, well, thank you all very much. Again, I'm happy to go into the gory details, and I do have a demo over in the demo room. Whenever we're in there, feel free to stop by.
And thank you, John. And you know, you really have to be worried when John says, that's too expensive for me.